Hi everyone, my name is Irene. I'm a researcher at Protocol Lab, and in this talk I'm going to present Monza, that is a new two-party protocol for secure computation of functions that are defined over the rings through decay. And this is a joint work with Dario Catalano, Mario Di Raimondo, and Dario Fiore. So we look at this problem. We have two parties, Alice and Bob, with private inputs A and B, and they want to compute a public function f over this input without revealing the inputs. And the way we solve this is design an interactive protocol for Alice and Bob, such that even one of the two parties is corrupted and does not follow the instruction of the protocol stays as secure as sending inputs to a trusted third party that computes the output and return only this to Alice and Bob. So this is the standard MPC problem, just for the very specific case of two parties only. And there are a lot of MPC protocols that solve this problem, and usually this protocol, they consider the function f as a binary circuit, like for example Yao scheme does this, or as a circuit over a finite field. In this work, we take a different approach and we assume that the function f is represented as an arithmetic circuit but over a ring, specifically the ring of the integers modulo 2 to the k, so z2k for short. And why do we do this? This choice comes from the fact that one is interesting and two is an interesting problem, and two, actually, the integer arithmetic on standard CPU is done modulo 2 to the k for a specific value of k. So an MPC protocol that is designing this model is simply to implement, because you know the arithmetic of the protocol is the same arithmetic of the machine implementing it, and then can implement very easily tricks and the sub-protocols that are used for this CPU computation to speed up this computation. So at the end, we get a protocol, an MPC protocol that is fast in practice as well. We are not the first one to look at this model. Actually, there are feasibility results that says that MPC is possible even in the dishonest majority case over a ring for any ring, finite ring, of course. And there is also a framework for a very specific case, the three-party case with one correction, design a very efficient protocol for computation over the specific ring 2 to the k. This is the SHARMBIND framework. And quite recently, Kramer and others, a crypto 2 years ago, they also extended the tools that are used in many protocols of the Spitz family to compute over field. They extend this tool to compute over a ring. So they designed what they call the Spitz-2K protocol. And there are already some variation of this protocol. For example, over the 2K was presented quite recently. And with all of this line of work, and we present a new protocol that we call it Monza, that is specific for the two-party case, achieves active security, and as Spitz-2K is in the preprocessing model. Actually, we have the same online phase of Spitz-2K, but we have a different preprocessing. We use for the first time this scheme that is called Joest-Liebert scheme, that is very well suited for this MPC preprocessing over the ring. It's very well suited for this because it's linearly homomorphic. It naturally support as message space the ring that we are interested in. It's quite efficient, the basic operation like encryption, decryption, and the homomorphic operation are really efficient. Moreover, it doesn't need this encryption scheme doesn't need zero knowledge proof of plaintext knowledge. So this is a plus for the MPC preprocessing application. However, it still needs some kind of zero knowledge proof, specifically zero knowledge proof for correct multiplication. And the challenge here is that such proofs were not known in the literature before this work. So in order to be able to use this Joest-Liebert scheme and exploit all this nice feature, the challenge we had to overcome was actually design this specific protocol. And I'll tell you more in the following of this talk. But before, I want to say that Monza is also efficient in practice. We implemented the pre-processing phase in C and we did some benchmarks and tests. You can read all the details of this in the paper. Here I want to say two things. First of all, the throughput of the pre-processing phase, so how many triples, for example, we generate per second, it stays the same or almost the same, even if the connection between the two parties is low. So the throughput for triples with a very good connection, LAN connection with 0.5 millisecond between the two parties as latency is 19. If we go down with to a very slow connection with 100 millisecond, we still have a good throughput that is 70. So just two triples less. This is a nice feature for specific application. And also, computation-wise, we have that, the role of the two parties is not symmetric. We have one party that always has to do like more operation or like more complex operation, okay? So this means that Monza can be very well, it can be a good choice in the model where we have a server, a client, and the server is has more computational power than the client. Okay, these are some features, and now I want to start to construct the protocol. And for this, I'll start recalling you how a speech-like protocol looks. We have two tools here. First of all, we have a secret sharing, an arithmetic secret sharing, specifically the additive one, meaning that any value, like for example A, is represented as a pair of values, A1 and A2, such that the sum is the value, and such that Alice only know A1, Bob only know A2. And we also have an information theoretic MAC, message authentication code. And this means that there is a global key that stays the same, call it delta, and it stays the same for the entire protocol. And this key is used with each value to create this MAC. This MAC is just the product between the key and the value, and the MAC is also clearly secret shared. These are the two tools that in the speeds family are used for all the online phase of all for all the protocols there. And usually these tools are used, especially the MAC is used on a field. Very recently, as I told you before, Kramer and others, they extended this they adapted this tool to work on computation over the ring Z2 to the K. And how did they do it? So the key idea is the following. If you want to compute on Z2 to the K, you actually need to go to, let's say, an extension ring. So that is a ring that is large, as it has other S bits, okay? So more specifically, say you have a value A in Z2 to the K, what you are going to take, you are going to take an A prime in Z2 K plus S, such that the first K bits are equal, that is these two values are equal modulo 2 to the K, and then you are going to secret share and authenticate the value A prime, okay? And you are doing this for all the inputs, and then you are going to do the computation over the ring to the K plus S. So the online phase of speech-to-like is basically the same of the online phase of speeds, meaning that any linear operation in the function is executed locally on the shares by the parties. And for multiplication, to have an efficient way to do multi-creation, we use random triples. A random triple is three values, X, Y, and Z, they are in a shared authenticated form, and the first two, X and Y, are random, while Z is the product of X times Y. And once that you have a random triple, we have a standard tool trick called the Beaver formula to also do multiplication, okay? So this is quite known, standard, and the key point here is that how do we get this random triple? So here is where the pre-processing comes into play. Basically, before doing the online computation, there must be a pre-processing phase that uses some cryptographic primitives, for example, public key crypto, to generate these random triples and other correlated randomness that we may need. So if you think how to create these triples in this offline phase, pre-processing phase, you can realize quite soon that basically all you need is a multiplication protocol. Indeed, like generating random values is easy because each party can just take their own shares of this value. What is complicated is, for example, to mark this value because you have to do a multiplication between the two shared value, and this involves multiplication between like two share, one known by Alice and one known by Bob. So if we design a protocol to multiply two values, one known by Alice, one by Bob, and this multiplication protocol will return the shares of this multiplication, then basically we are done. We can use this to construct triples. Okay, so how do we do multiplication between secrets? There are like again several protocols that use different primitives, different building blocks. For example, you can use Oblivious Transfer. You are going to have a quite cheap protocol that is, however, bandwidth intense. You can use homomorphic encryption, different flavor. For example, the original SPIDS protocol used somewhat homomorphic encryption, meaning that an encryption scheme that is linearly homomorphic and also allow you to compute, say, the multiplication to ciphers or like manipulate two ciphers to get the encryption of the multiplication of the two original values. Or you can use something simple like linear homomorphic encryption only. We take this up. Let me say, first of all, that there is no one that is best or that is the best. They all have these pros and cons. For example, as I said before, Oblivious Transfer is cheap in computation but bandwidth intense. Using homomorphic encryption gives you something that is much better in communication, so requires less communication but is more intense for computation, computation requires more computation. So there are different flavors, different solutions, and we present a new solution that uses a simply linear homomorphic encryption scheme, and in particular, the encryption scheme that we choose is this Joy Libert for all the nice features I told you at the beginning. So let me recall you what this scheme is. This is basically an extension, a generalization, let's say, of the Goldwasser-Mikulicz scheme, and instead of encrypting bits, it encrypts a string of bits or like element of the rings 2 to the n. The public key is a ring, an RSA modulo n, with the generator of the group of the invertible element modulo n. This generator has to be actually a special one. It has to have the Jacobi symbol equal to 1, and Jacobi symbol is just an extension of the Legendre symbol that you can compute when you know P and Q. Okay? So, some, like, let's say, number theoretic specific characterization are needed here. But when you have this, you can encrypt your message just taking your message, for example, m, just doing g to the m, so generator to the m, and then you randomize the encryption, taking a random value x and elevating this to the power 2 to the n, the order of the plain text space. Okay, so once that we have this, how do we use it to do the multiplication protocol? It's quite simple. So again, remember that we have Alice with input x, Bob with input y, and they want to compute a secret sharing of this x times y, okay? We also assume that Alice has public and secret key for the Joy Libert scheme, while Bob only has the public key. So the protocol goes like this. Alice sends the encryption of x to Bob. Bob takes this cipher test, A, and use the homomorphic property of the scheme to compute C, that is y times a, y is input, plus the encryption of a random value. R. R is chosen by Bobby itself. And send back this value C to Alice. Alice decrypts and gets her shares, basically. So defines her shares that one as decryption of C, while Bob defines his share as minus R. And it's quite easy to verify that Z1 plus Z2 now is actually X times Y. So we have a secret shedding of the multiplication of the two inputs. Perfect. Security for Bob is super easy because Alice can cheat, basically, can do anything. What is challenging here is how do we achieve security for Alice? So when Bob is corrupted, he could, for example, send this C computed in a wrong form, okay? So in order to avoid this, we had to add a zero knowledge proof of the fact that C is actually YA plus encryption of R, okay? And the challenge is here, because such a protocol is not known for the J-Libert scheme. And moreover, since J-Libert works on a ring, it's not easy to take standard NOR-like protocols and adapt to work in this case, because we have the non-invertible element, we have all the problems that being on a ring brings with, for example, not all elements are invertible, and so we can't divide easily by elements that are non-zero. I'll tell you more about this, but first let me do a precision. Let me do a comment. Let me precise one thing. This is what we want to prove. What we need to prove to have the multiplication protocol to be secure. So we have to prove this blue statement that you see in the slide. That was the one in the previous protocol. However, for the rest of this talk, I'm going to focus on something that is simpler, just for the sake of simplicity, and that is actually proving that Bob wants to convince Alice that he knows M such that the public ciphertext C is the encryption of M without revealing M, okay? The key ideas are similar. The first protocol is the one we need is more involved, so we're going to focus on the simpler one for the, at least doing this talk. So let's construct this simpler protocol to understand the key ideas. And we're going to construct it as a SNOR-like protocol. So the first thing that is going to happen is that Bob, the prover, is going to sample another message, S, and to encrypt this message with the same key, clearly, but with new randomness, W, and send this encryption back to Alice, Alice, she is going to choose a challenge as an element of Z2 to the X, 2 to the S, so could be a bit string, let's say it's a bit, morally it's a bit string of S element, we interpret it as an element of this new ring Z2 to the S. And this challenge is received by Bob, who computes two values, X and Y. These two values can be computed by just knowing M. And if these two values are computed correctly, like following this formula, then when they are sent to Alice can use them to verify a specific algebraic formula, the one you see on the slide. If this formula is true, she accepts the proof, otherwise she rejects. And correctness, again, it's just doing some math, it's quite easy. And the soundness in this kind of protocol usually is proven in this way. We assume that Alice is sending more than a challenge, like A and A prime, they are different challenges. And we say, if Bob can answer both of them, then basically we can compute this M, that means Bob is not lying. So if Bob answers many challenges, he is not lying. And the way we compute is that we use the algebraic formulas that is used by Alice to verify. We use that formula with different challenge, as we compose them together, we get basically a formula for m. This formula usually depends on the inverse of that element e minus e prime, the two different challenges. And while if you are on a field, this is fine because you can invert this element. This element is different than zero, so you can invert. You cannot do this on a ring because on a ring, there are non-invertible elements. There are actually in the ring to the end, there are a lot of them. All even elements are not invertible, for example. So how can we adapt this strategy? How can we overcome this problem? So what we show in the paper is that actually this value e minus e prime and 2 to the n, they have the great common divisor is always 2 to the t for some t that is smaller than s, the bit length of the challenge that is also smaller than n. Okay? So we can basically simplify a factor 2 to the t from both of these. And once that you do this, you can at that point you can actually invert the new value, the simplified value. Here you don't invert in the ring 2 to the n, but you invert in the ring that is smaller, 2 to the n minus f. And this means that you basically you are extracting, you are computing, you have a formula for m that only extract, compute and extract the first n minus 2 bits of it. So if you actually want to extract all the message, now you have to go back, start from scratch, and start your zero knowledge protocol with a larger message space. You have to work from the beginning on the ring Z2 to the n plus s. If you do this, then you basically extract all s when you extract just the first n bits. And notice that this is not an efficient problem. We can do this like going to the extension field, extension ring. It's not a problem for efficiency because the cipher test length stays the same with this Joliber scheme. Okay, so if you wrap all together, basically now I hope you get idea of this zero knowledge protocol of correct multiplication. It's going to be similar to this one I show you, but more involved. And you can use it to construct your, you can use it in the multiplication protocol, and the multiplication protocol is then used in to generate triples. There are a lot of details how you use all these together that you can find in the paper. Let me skip them here. Instead, I want to talk like a minute about the computation, the communication complexity of Monza, of the preprocessing phase. So the nice thing is that we are able to compute the explicit formula of the communication complexity. So all constants are explicit. Clearly, the communication complexity is linear in the cipher test length and in the input length and in the length of these extra S bits that we need for security. But it's not just that in linear, we have explicit constant. You can see the formula there in the slide. The formula translates to kind of translate to explicit numbers when you plug them in. And there is an example that, for example, for 80 bits computational security, and this S, our statistical security parameter, were equal to 40, less than 70 kilobits are needed for a triple on a triple where the input size is 128 bit. And you also see a table there that you can read more details about it in the paper. But basically, this is the table that compares our protocol with the Speech2k protocol. We achieve a very similar communication complexity. And usually, Monza is more efficient, meaning it needs less communication. 1k is a bit larger, like for example, for K128, Monza is more efficient. Okay, before concluding, I just want to say that the words have some interesting direction for future works. For example, it would be nice to see if we can extend this protocol to the n-party case. Something interesting also designing a batch verification for the zero knowledge proof, because we do a lot of them. No? For each triples, you need a number of the zero knowledge proof. Imagine if you can batch verify them, you gain a lot in efficiency. And then also maybe you want for some specific application, it would be interesting to design sub protocols that can exploit the JL unique properties. And with this, it is all. Thank you a lot for watching, and bye bye.